No, thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Thank you for having such an elaborate introduction of mine. I know this is an extremely risky proposition, and it is as risky as the challenge that Corona poses, because you know satisfaction is a function of expectation and perception. And with this high, an elaborate introduction raises the expectation bar, and if we assume that the perception is of at the same level, the dissatisfaction is bound to be there. So you are threatening me with that, posing me towards that challenge. Anyways, let me first welcome on behalf of University of Lucknow and also on my own behalf, Mr. Syed Rizvi. He is head cognitive division businesses of TCS North America, Professor Pia Polsa from Hankin School of Economics, Mr. Sudhir from Book My Show, Mr. Rajiv. Dean, Faculty of Commerce has just left. Head of Department, Professor Medhavi. I can see so many esteemed faculty members from the university, including my Dean of Student Welfare. I can see some of my research scholars and former research scholars as well. I can see several faces who I can recognize who are from management fraternity and who have been doing exceedingly well in the area of marketing and otherwise. So I welcome you all from the bottom of my heart on behalf of University of Lucknow, which is my, these days, the host institution, and also on my personal behalf. I am surprised to see that such a wonderful department of this great seat of learning is holding its first ever seminar. But then, better late than never, I can clearly remember when I called Professor Ritu Narang to think of something, because all of the departments have been doing excellently well in propagation of information and knowledge. But then finally, within less than a week's time, she has been able to muster such a wonderful pool of and galaxy of speakers in this. And very importantly is that she has been able to muster listeners. This is extremely difficult. Finding speakers are easy. So, but she has been able to muster a number of listeners, which is commendable job. So I congratulate you, madam, for hosting such a wonderful thing. I congratulate the entire department mates of yours. Having said this, to start with, as I said, first challenge Professor Ritu Narang posed before me. Besides, there are three more challenges in the premise of which I'm starting. First is, of course, we all realize the challenge of Corona. Second is, we as a teacher would certainly like live to interact with live audience. And it as a teacher, it does not get a feel of speaking over someone who are not visible. But the most important is the time limit that I had been given by the organizing secretary of this e-seminar. And that was 30 minutes, out of which 5 minutes went on to introduction. And remaining 25 minutes is the time within which I have to share the work that I have been doing in the area of my choice. And, you know, interestingly, this is the only work that I know in the world. So, and we did a lot of work in this area along with my students, my management students, and also my doctoral research student. This is the area that I have been working. I should acknowledge the contribution of my research scholar, Palima, who helped me in preparing this presentation. Actually, she made the presentation extremely beautiful. So a credit is due to you, Palima. Now the work is, what is the purpose of any business organization? It is creation and retention of customer. And I'm not saying this, Peter Drucker says this, so you've got lesser chance of arguing. Peter Drucker said, the purpose of any business is creation and retention of customer. But the question always comes in, who is the customer? So you all know, I'm not going into the basics. You all are professionals. So, but an important statistics that I would like to share with respect to dynamics of the customer character, and that is what the American Society of Quality and Anderson Consulting Inc. in their report brought out following findings. A, And in Indian context, it becomes more interesting to observe. Customer tells 8 friends about a satisfying experience and 20 friends about a negative experience. So it's not only India society, but the entire global society is actually chugalkhor by nature. It is easier to influence existing customers to buy 10% more than to increase the customer base by 10%. 80% of successful new product and service ideas come from existing customers, and repeat customers cost 1/5 of, actually this data through various studies, of late it got revised to 1/5 to 1/8, depending on the product category we are talking of, less than new customers and can substantially increase profits. Now, we all know this led to redefinition of the conventional model of customer satisfaction to customer delight. I'll share some of the examples which recent changes took place across certain industries. Like you could see United Bank of India, their catch line says the bank that begins with you. Now this you is important. This you is the customer. ICICI Bank before Khayal Aapka, they had hum aapke hain na, hum aapke hain. Sorry, it was based on the movie called Hum Aapke Hain something. It was Hum Hai Na. So from Hum Hai Na, that is boasting on the strength of the company, they shifted the power onto the customer stating Khayal Aapka. So it is the customer that had been leading. I would like to draw the attention to this initiative that Coca-Cola has been starting. And I would like to draw the attention of my Dean of Student Welfare, because ice breaking is extremely important, especially when the new session begins and new students come in. I would like to quote here, one important factor is that education is one such industry which is extremely peculiar. And one peculiarity of this industry is that in this very industry, students are the customers as well as students are the product. This does not happen in any other industry. So this is very peculiar industry, and a special care is required in building a relationship with these students. So Coca-Cola, what did was a friendly twist. They initiated a friendly twist campaign where it said Coca-Cola launched a campaign in Colombia where college freshmen were given Coke bottles on their first day of campus. The caps of these bottles could be opened only by clicking together with another cap. This encouraged students to team up and leading to conversations between strangers on the first day of college. The company played a key role in breaking the ice among the freshmen. This initiative reflected Coca-Cola's brand image, a part of which is the beginning of important friendships and the sharing of joyful, long-lasting memories. Similarly, you have seen this Ola, we all have experienced upgrading to upper segment. Axis Bank offering priority relationship managers. Even Indian Railway, conventional operator like Indian Railways have started opting for, though their premise was first come, first serve. Traditionally, it has been, and conventionally for corporates, it has been based on certain objective parameter. Those objective parameters were largely guided by the profitability. Airtel's open network ad, which said the open network makes available to user information about network coverage and signal strength across the country, in addition to network sites deployment status. Even in politics, you know, politics is also no inferior in industry than other corporates. And you can think of what was the value assigned to a voter by a political organization or a political leader 20 years back, and what is it today? Even one gets open communication avenue for people to talk to and at least lodge the ideas with the authorities, with the policy makers. We all have seen how successful late Sushma Madam's initiative while she was Minister for External Affairs, and Prabhuji, Suresh Prabhuji, who has been an extremely popular railway minister, who initiated all this. But what is the reason for all these specific initiatives? And the reason has been the competition. There is a clutter at all these places. And I would like to draw your attention to the following commercial. So you could see how this competition even took an ugly shape. There are certain other examples like the Flipkart, which says the big billion day, the Snapdeal says for others it could be a big day. For us, today is no difference. That is, all days are big days. Then those who are aware of this famous Audi BMW competition, which took a new bottom low. Same was the case with Pantene and Dove when it came to shampoo category. But what has been the effect of this competition? Competition has been because of homogeneity of marketing mix across companies. Adverse, the customer loyalty was one factor that was affected badly. And it is because of competition that there has been increased customer expectation, especially pertaining to recognition of self, round the clock wish for products, and response speed also is expected to be extremely, extremely high. Even in our university, we find students coming down, walking down anytime, anywhere, and expect their issues to be resolved then and there. And it is not very improper and imprudent, but then certainly there are issues that it has been because of competition. So ultimately, any transaction has to be value transaction. And it is for the marketer to appreciate what this customer value is. Actually, this customer value is a function of benefit upon cost. Now, traditionally, there has been a denominator-driven value creation proposition, which over a period of time and advent of modern marketing, it got shifted from denominator-driven to numerator-driven. That is, for example, if we take, say, three petrol stations in on one side of the road, and you go to one petrol station, what happens? Price of the petrol is the same, and he gives you good fuel and proper fillage. But then when you go to the next one says, okay, I'll give you this plus this along with cleaning of your windshield and the namaste and a proper welcome and a small music. But the third one says, if you go to first or second, you do not go to the third one. So third one says, look, if you come to me, you buy a certain voucher, I'll give you, say, 2% extra fuel. Now here, the effect is being undertaken to alter the values of numerator. Relationship became an extreme. So homogeneity of all marketing mix parameters, the remedy found in relationship company was found to be the one factor that could create superior value to the customers. But what is relationship? And it is extremely important to explain what is relationship, and let us think beyond the typical traditional relationship status that we write on our Facebook page, which is single, engaged, or married. So relationship is an empathetic state between the company and the customer, where both perceive mutual benefit in each other's company and pursue practices for sustained stay. I'm not going into all these, but then even during this COVID time, I would like to share the initiative of ICICI Bank, which taking the cue from COVID-19 outbreak, they initiated something to address to their customers in special reference to this COVID. How could they strengthen the bond of relationship? There are certain theories that I'm deliberately skipping, considering the time. And of course, there has been benefit of this customer relationship management practices to customers as well as to the company. Even for the customer, it has been recognition of requirement, need fulfillment, exclusive need fulfillment, speedier service, service accuracy, increased confidence, lesser uncertainty, customer concerns, and greater value for money. But very importantly, for the company, it has had a superior value. So it was, of course, perpetual stream of revenue, increased retention, opportunity to cross-sell and upsell, provides premium, positive referral creation, high customer lifetime value, lowering cost of sale, reduced marketing time, and building. At the end of the day, the goal of marketing, which is to build customer loyalty, this is what the company can actually get. out of implementation of relationship management. But very important issue with respect to customer relationship management is that worldwide, what should be the implementation framework, this has been grossly missing. So in past few years, CRM industry has witnessed a moderate growth. And one thing I should also tell you before going out of that implementation model, that let us not consider relationship, customer relationship management as just an IT product. Information technology is only a support tool to facilitate implementation of customer relationship management in an organization to strengthen, because the marketing shifted from transactional marketing to relationship marketing. And that is why out of this six-step model, it is only one step where information technology is being leveraged. Of course, there are several other ways of using it in the greater interest of the organization. So in the past few years, CRM industry has witnessed a moderate growth. CRM projects are capable of achieving high return on investment, but they are suffering from high failure rates. So where lies the solution? It is the CRM framework that we are going to discuss today that addresses the marketing issues that come. There certainly had been certain issues of conventional customer relationship management practices, which was, of course, lack of technological support, restricted to a smaller group of customers, limited to specific trades, was largely unorganized and unstructured, absence of expansive and holistic approach, failure in re-engineering of business processes, lack of organizational integration, lack of strategic perspective, disintegration between multidimensional component of CRM, absence of process-oriented cross-functional conceptualization of CRM, disintegration between technological and strategic approach, lack of customer relationship management performance management system, absence of integrated framework, absence of causal structure, non-consideration of employee satisfaction, and certainly absence of customer lifetime value approach. But what is actually CRM that we are going to talk of? We are going to talk of that it is a continuously updated process of identifying relative value of customers and designing customized company interaction to delight them so that they do not just remain with the company profitably, but also be the company's ambassador. Full involvement and empowerment of employees and appropriate technology are two essentials for successful CRM. Now, something that I'm going to talk about is this is what the premise where we are going to start it from. Now, this is the 6C step that we are talking about. This is the hierarchical architecture. Stage one starts with customer lifetime value assessment. We'll subsequently go to each individual C and we'll see what does this mean. So customer lifetime value assessment is one. After assessing the lifetime value of the customer, the second stage is segmentation and profiling of the customer so that the exclusive need identification can be done with respect to the customer's specific needs. Third comes, now let us come back to the process and create a product which meets the exclusive requirements of the customer, that is content customization. Then comes the role of a computer-aided communication design, which can ensure 24/7 effective communication the way customer wants. Fourth is the competency mapping between what the customer's requirements are and what the company can offer. And last but not the least is the feedback system. So this is the 6E model that is being proposed for the hierarchical architecture. Now, lifetime value, as you know, is about optimizing each interaction and conversation in order to create an engaged customer relationship, which drives customer retention, repeat purchases, customer referrals, reduce support cost, and possibly even charge price premiums. So CLTV, customer lifetime value, is the total monetary value realized by the company out of customers' sustained stay with the company, bringing in increased consumption benefits arising out of superior relationships. There are two ways of calculating lifetime value. One is the historical lifetime value, that is, since you have been with the company, what is the total revenue that you have produced to the organization? Second is the predictive lifetime value, which is of greater significance, especially in the modern businesses. If you keep staying with the organization for all the days to come, what is the total revenue that the organization can accrue out of your stay for the entire lifetime? There are certain mathematical formulations of assessing this lifetime value. This is the core basic arithmetic equation when the nature of rate of change in consumption is discrete. So here it is M1, which denotes the total expenditure made by the customer in first year, multiplied by 1 plus R by 100 to the power N minus 1 divided by R by 100, where N denotes the total number of years of customers stay with the company and R denotes the annual rate of growth in the expenditure. But normally what happens is our consumptions are not discrete in nature, rather it is continuous. So arithmetic equations are restricted with the limitation of registering the responses which cannot be practically converted for all the practical consumption values can less be done this. So what I subsequently did was to account for the consumptions that are continuous in nature, the time horizon would require limit continuity theory. And here the final value that comes out to be, since this has not been published yet, so I'm not I'm not sharing this. This is the final value that I've arrived at, through which the continuous consumption can also be checked in, and we can formulate actually what would be the value that comes in. Now, after, and this is the algorithm through which, based on this algorithm, subsequent coding can be done to create the softwares which will register. Now, it does happen, like for example, you have visited say a hotel twice in a year. And normally what happens is when you go to the hotel, they ask for, like, the banks charge, ask for our KYC. Most of these service providers also ask for those KYCs in some different forms. So in those different forms, what we normally get is the family income, family size, and the frequency, based on which it is through this that one can project what is the total money that the organization can be accrued to, can receive from the customer if the customer can be made satisfied and happily stay with the organization. Accordingly, but then what happens is, like for example, there are separate sections, segments created for the customer based on the lifetime value. Different customers have got different requirements and different needs based on which they can be, satiated. So based on the predictive lifetime value estimation, different customer segments are created. These segments are then analyzed on the parameter of accessibility, differentiability, responsiveness, and profitability. So subsequent mapping of the segment is to be done on the basis of segment serving ability of the company. This is what the customer profitability matrix is, where the two parameters are the pass margins and the potential margins. So here companies can use in segmenting the customers and designing the offers. But very important factor here post segmentation is profiling of the customer. So if a rich Marwadi is a frequent traveler in an aviation company, may not like to be served a drink or a non-veg food, which otherwise could be treated as premium. So this profiling that way is extremely important. So customer segment thus selected needs to be profiled. Profiling can be done based on five parameters: customer purchase behavior, customer connect, customer persona, creating customer persona, customer location, and customer description. So after customer lifetime value identification has been done, based on lifetime value, segmentation and subsequent profiling has been done. Now, post profiling, content customization is a must. So how does and what exactly is the need of the product? In one of the study I did find, and even at the time of when Kingfisher Airline used to rule the Indian skies, is that a typical person who is extremely, extremely frequent traveler would hesitate in opening with the relationship with the relationship only because of the extremely elegance exhibited by the operators. So this, instead of adding and augmenting the relationship, it used to act as a detriment in furthering of the relationship. So content customization, that was extremely important. In design, I have personally witnessed in banks in Varanasi, which is probably the biggest trading center between Kanpur to Patna, that is 6 kilometers, 300 kilometers radius, is that a very strong, extremely wealthy businessman, when visits the bank branch and sees that passbook nahi denge. Now this passbook nahi denge acts as a big detriment, because he ultimately wants, or the person is speaking such a wonderful English, this does not let furtherance of the relationship and deepening of the relationship. So in design of product, customization can be attempted through digital marketing tools and techniques. This is in case of customization of the product. It is important to take cognizance of following issues in customization. Very important is customer's profile parity, which we have already done at stage two. But second and very important is revenue cost parity. That is, what is the total return that the organization is going to receive? Because every customization is a cost to the organization, right? And then comes computer-aided communication design, because it is extremely important to keep the modern customer engaged, to ensure sustenance of 24/7 communication. Through computer-aided communication design design, there are following benefits that can accrue to the organization. One is customer information accuracy. So, aadmi galti karta hai, machine galti nahi karti. 24/7 communication is possible. Cost optimization can be done. Customization can be done. And very important is user control. So if you want to say, for example, if the organization provides you an opportunity to communicate through maybe SMS or WhatsApp or email or website, or even bots or virtual VCRs, which we call as virtual customer representatives, we can do this and with lesser cost. So user control is always in the hands of the customer. Customer interface requires attention and responses. And I am gradually speaking onto, I'm not going into the technical details of this. So there are, of course, so many information technology tools like data warehousing and data mining. There are certain popular communication technology, which says voice portals are there, web phones, bots. Bots means e-robot, virtual customer representatives. Then there are some very popular CRM softwares like Siebel, Oracle, MySAP, PeopleSoft, JD Edwards, etc., etc. Then comes the HR issue, which talks about competency mapping. Now, different people like to be served differently. So employees need to have the ability to judge, acknowledge, and act accordingly. Employees in modern marketing literature are being considered as internal customers. So digital marketing tools have been leveraged to create a system whose competency can be mapped with the requirement of the customers. So competency creation is the first stage. Considering the specific requirements of the customer, competency creation is required. It's a three-stage process. One is competency identification, which involves identification of knowledge, skill, and motive. So competency is a function of these three traits: knowledge, skill, and motive. And so identification of all these three is a must. Then competency gap analysis is important. This involves employee competency assessment and compare it with the requirements identified. And third is competency development. So whatever the gap is, imparting competency to bridge the competency gap identified above. Now, building compatible employee competency mapping, which requires training, orientation, involvement, empowerment, and last but not the least is the feedback. So this is a five-stage process. And last but not the least, as I said, is consistent customer satisfaction. The CRM process has to be evaluated by the customers for the satisfaction it renders. So something that I started with, I'll reintroduce it. Is that customer satisfaction or otherwise dissatisfaction is the cognitive judgment, though many of the marketing modern literature talk it as cognitive as well as emotional judgment of a customer resulting out of an interaction between the customer's personality and customer's marketing practices in the perspective of the expectation customer had with the product and perception of the benefits received. So it is the company which through its marketing practices, say in service company, we talk of product, price, place, promotion, people, process, and physical evidences, get exposed onto the customer. Now, customer is a makeup of, is made up of variety of factors. It is the family or social background, the education, the cognition, the psychology, the experience, emotion, and expertise. So this is what a customer is made up of. When the company is exposed onto the customer, there are two basic broad parameters within which the customer evaluates. One is the expectation, second is the perception. Now, if the perception is more than that of expectation, it leads to a state of satisfaction and subsequent feedback goes on to the redesigning of marketing practices. If otherwise, that is if expectation is more than that of perception, it again acts as, it is a state of dissatisfaction, which subsequently acts as an input for the organization, for the company's marketing practices to subsequently revisit. So actually, satisfaction is a function of expectation and perception. So when we open the equation, we finally find this mathematical equation. And there are the algorithm which may enable the organization to create these platforms for assessment of satisfaction based on these two. Because, and very important is, say if, for example, there are 20 parameters leading to the satisfaction formation. Now, these in these 20 parameters, not all the parameters will carry equal weight. So these weight identifications are extremely important. And that is why this W is actually the weight assigned by the customer to different determinants of satisfaction. N is the number of determinants. S stands for determinant of satisfaction for perception. That is ith, I is the number, and similarly for E. So based on this equation, we can always calculate this. Having said this, ours is one institution probably in the country which has been extremely proactive with respect to implementation of this. In our organization. And I can take shelter of this Corona model. What our institution has done with respect to the reinventing the academics of our institution during this Corona period. What we did was, as academics has got two important components. One is the teaching, second is the innovation. So in teaching, what we did was we again resorted to a 3C model, which talks of first conduct of classes. We leveraged information technology tremendously with respect to conduct of our classes. And, you know, even to the extent of that ours is a regular university and not a technical and very technologically savvy industry, largely into BABSC, BCom model, popularly we call it as BABSC, BCom model. Even in our university, the different departments have been placing the timetable of the e-classes or information technology classes on our website so that students can be can get access to all these. Second and very important was that what we have been doing is that even conduct of class had been on a mutually agreed time. So I personally know that many of the teachers used to take their classes at 9 in the evening because some rural area students were getting greater internet access and greater speed on internet and night during night. So first, what we did was first C of our classes was a conduct of class. Second was with respect to creation of content. Here also what we did was we created our esteemed faculty members created our contents. Very importantly, unlike many of the very leading institutions in the country, we placed our created information technology platform on the information technology platform. The content that we had created, we placed on our website in an open access model so that any student, be it our own or of our associate colleges or any student all across the globe, can access to the content developed by our teachers. Subsequently, what we have started doing was that in our library, because our library is one unique library which provides remote access. So during the Corona period only, we could create over 4,000 accounts, user ID passwords of our student to access to the e-books and e-journals that are available in our website. So what we started doing was that in our library, we would be creating in any library, what we find is we find a section of, say, textbooks, reference books, maybe e-books, journals, etc., etc. We are creating a separate section for the e-content developed by our faculty members. So this was creation of content. And the sole decision was based on the sheer confidence that the institution has on the competence of its faculty members. Third was connect with student. In this connect with student, very importantly, during this Corona period, we launched two of our student mentoring program. One was our student OPD. Now, OPD is largely a medical term used for outpatient department. We used it as our pupils' day, where 1 hour in a week is exclusively assigned by each faculty member for students. And I can say with a lot of pride and a lot of confidence that this came very, very handy for us to establish some kind of contact with our students, especially when the students were under tremendous stress and anxiety of classes and examinations, admissions, and so many career issues. So this acted as this. And during our OPDs, student OPDs, the students are free to contact to the teacher on any issue, be it personal or professional. So this was very, very important. This acted as a very, very important issue. Second scheme that we launched during this Corona period only was that TREE model. TREE is an abbreviation of teaching, reaching, emboldening, and evolving. This was an exclusive mentoring program launched during this period for our postgraduate students. Besides, we also, in order to strengthen and build up the confidence of the people, of our students, who are actually the purpose of business, as you could refer to the very first slide. What we did was we launched a separate financial scheme for our students. We renamed the financial scholarship scheme, and then it was earlier Poor Boys Fund, which we got it converted and got it approved through all these statutory bodies. We got it converted into student welfare program, student welfare scheme, and within which we launched two important schemes. One was a Karma Yogi scheme, which is a kind of earn while learn scheme, where a student can work for 50 days in a year for 2 hours a day on the exclusive skill that the student has. So for example, if he's a library science student, can work in our library. If he's a computer science student, can work in our office. If he's a commerce student, can work in our accounts department. If he's a civil engineering student, work with our engineering section, and so on and so forth. Similarly, another scheme, which was a scholarship scheme, which we expanded the horizon and expanded the financial outgo for the students. So this was a 3C model, which was conduct of class, creation of content, and content connect with student, which was an exclusive student relationship management, is actually aimed at building the larger canvas, but we extensively used it during the corona, even the crisis period. So the challenge that I was talking about at the very beginning of my presentation was that this is what, this is not just a standard model, an academic model, but has got tremendous implementation value. And this is what we have done in our institution. And I think I'm extremely happy with the kind of response that I have received from both sides, the demand and supply, that is the student as well as the teacher side. So this is all that I had to speak about the customer relationship management. I again extend my best wishes for the successful and meaningful outcome of such a wonderful program, which I received. It has still got 783 participants, and I was congratulating Professor Narang, not for mastering speakers, but for mastering listeners. And you have been successful that for past almost 40 minutes I have been speaking. I extended the time that I got, but then people are still listening. So congratulations to you. You have been able to find the listeners for the program. I would certainly be waiting for the outcome that we got. I was provided with some of the questions, and I tried to address some of them, but then, you know, given the time and given the content that I had to share with, it was extremely difficult to attend to all the questions. But certainly after the closing of all the presentation, we would certainly like to address the questions. If not in this program, you can always mail it and we can revert. Okay. Thank you very much for being a patient listener. Thank you very, very much for giving me an opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Ajay Prakash. So we've just shortlisted all of those questions, just put them into two heads, of which one of them would be shortlisted. You've already gone ahead with. It's very good that you decoded the CRM architecture framework, not only in theory, but it also came up in practice. So you've showed the academic world how this CRM architecture applies to the universities and the academic world. So I'll just put one small question. That one is, what difference will the post COVID era bring about in managing trust among customers hesitant to transact online?
See, I were provided with a lot of questions. I was already provided with the questions that you are referring to by madam. You know, very subtly, I passed on to some of the questions in one of the statements that I made, that CRM largely has been considered as an IT tool. Initially, it used to be considered as an IT tool only. And very interestingly, once upon a time, out of the total IT sale, 35% of the total IT product sale used to come from CRM products only. But gone are the days. We, as a student of marketing, are focusing more on the conceptual dimensions of this. B, the second myth is that its implementation onto this online businesses only. See, what we are talking of is the implementation model. That is, this is the architecture through which customer relationship management concept has got to be transformed into when it comes to implementation of the concept. So first, there are two aspects to it. One is comprehension of the concept. Second is implementation of the concept. Now, at another level, when you're going to talk about all these, you're going to talk about implementation of these concepts with specific customization for different industries. So online business is one such industry. Second, with respect to this question, I should tell you, trust is a very, very comprehensive concept. So let us not belittle it by just using it as a term and start giving an answer to this. There are two words related to this. One is faith, one is trust. These two are different words having different concepts, extremely different concepts. In businesses, faith is important and not trust. This we have got to understand, because trust is repeated exposure of faith, and trust gets built over a time, over a period of time. Trusts are largely भगवान के साथ, परिवार के साथ. The relationships which are fragile in nature, there faith is more important. So the first stage of building relationship, in building relationship, actually these are the specific constructs that are part of customer loyalty building. So first stage that corporates work on is of building faith and not trust.
Fine.
So I was Thank not delving deeper into all these concepts because it leads to some kind of misnomer.
Thank you, sir. It's been very well explained. Now let me hand it over to Ritu once again. Ritu, please go ahead with the next proceeding.